if you can trust your ear, I guess, you trust your decades of experience, you can't really go wrong, right?
You nailed it. You nailed it. You trust your decades of experience because even your mistakes are worthy.
I think even more so than the things you do that you already know, because you're not learning otherwise, right? I mean, that's the...
Right. And your mistakes, I like to say, at least I say it in the book, The Music Lesson, at least the new one. Your mistakes might be music pushing you in the way she wants you to go. Where usually we're trying to go our way based off of a few years of experience and a brain the size of a grapefruit, as if we know what's supposed to happen. Music's been around a whole lot longer than us.
Right.
Why don't we let music have a say? And sometimes I treat my mistakes, okay, as that. Okay, this is what you want. Let's listen to it. Oh, you were right. Let's expand on that. And so I wrote with that in mind.
I love your thing where you ask the audience about what are the available notes for this scale. Now I'm going to improvise with all the ones you didn't mention.
Exactly.
And how the shock. I mean, I've been there in the room when you've done that at your camp, and the shock of people like, oh, that actually sounds really good. Like, what is that? You know, I think people get lost a little bit in that theory side. I know so many of the questions I get as somewhat of a teacher sometimes are like, you know, do you have tips on improvising? What are the scales I can use over this chord? And I try and encourage them to see slightly the bigger picture.
Well, Yannick, we still have teachers, not to mention names or anything, I'm not going down that road, but we still have teachers out there that say you can't play good music until you know what notes to play.
Yeah.
That's like telling a baby, I can't understand you and I won't even listen until you learn the right words.
Right.
It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
And so I like to show that to people, but what it does is not to prove a point. It's to free them up. Oh, wow, I can make good music today.
So what, this is super interesting. So as a teacher, and you are present in two very well-established teaching locations, your own Vicks Music Camps, of course, and now the association with Berklee and what Steve Bailey is doing over there in the bass department, I think is incredible. The people really he's bringing in, I think that's a game changer for that school. So, but aside from the obvious larger spectrum of ability, perhaps at your camp, because it's a bigger age range, it's definitely they're not all college level trying to be professional musicians. Aside from that obvious difference, what is the difference in feedback you get from students in both places, and what is expected from the students in both places? Like, what are those two dynamics like?
Well, there's a lot of the same and a lot of differences because we get the Berklee style musicians coming to our camp.
Right.
Okay, so in many of those cases, to start there, they've learned so much that you can fit their idea of music in a shoebox. Okay, this is what music is. If I'm in this key, I've got these seven notes I can play, but I only know five of them, the pentatonic scale, and I'm a bass player, so I only get to use one. You know, that's the idea. But the person who knows nothing, the idea is here. Right?
Yeah.
And in many cases, you come in with this, but the more you learn, it does this. Where it should be, it's us teachers' job to make sure that the more they learn, it does this.
Right.
Not get smaller.
You see possibility rather than restriction, right?
Right. You add to yourself in the process, not lose part of yourself, right? So with Berklee, it's getting them to realize that with what they have, if they learn to use what they have, they are good enough.
Yeah.
Right? And I tell the bass players this, I said, name a band or a gig that's out there making tons of money. And I mean real money. Mm-hmm. I don't mean jazz club money.
Right.
I mean, you know, Rolling Stones, whatever.
U2, yeah.
U2, right.
Yeah.
Totally popped in my head, exactly. No hard bass parts.
Oh.
Zero. None of the parts.
Adam Clayton, man. Eighth notes in a bar, that's it.
Exactly. So
really good eighth notes.
No, that's the difference. That's the difference. The parts aren't hard, right? But can you play that easy part? Right.
The commitment. I think people forget about the commitment to the width of the note and to the bigger picture, right?
Right. But at the same time, it does take time to understand and learn.
Yeah.
It's not difficult. It's not soloing through giant steps.
Yeah.
You know, where you got to learn all this theory before I can play. It's not that, right? So you have it. It's taking it and getting really good at this, where we're going to look over here and then have to come back to this, where we're already here. Let's deal with this as we move forward.